be master of your chosen with several strands of hope in your stable. You must remember all the same that at the crux of every game is knowing when it's time to leave the table. And it's important to be artful in your exit. No turning back, you must accept the con is done. But now and then you might recall the moments when you had it all. You had the charm, you had the talent, and my God, you had the fun. It was a ball, it was a blast, and it's a shame it couldn't last. But every chapter has to end, you must agree. It was a joy, it was sublime, a splendid way to earn a dime for a dirty, rotten guy like me. For a dirty, rotten guy like me. For a dirty, rotten guy like me.
Oh, why do you want to go to heaven? Not that I'm super religious. It was a bad simile, but I've always wanted to go to hell. My mom went there for undergrad, and I remember when I was little, I'd always see her walking around in her Yale sweatshirt, and she'd tell me all these stories about her amazing friends and crazy professors, and it just sounded so perfect. Yale was a part of who she was. How many colleges can make that much of an impact on someone? And she died when I was 10. She got hit by a drunk driver, and then she was just gone because of some idiot in a car. And I want to go to Yale because I want to have a family again. I want to live with hundreds of brilliant people, and I want to feel wanted. I want to meet my mother's professors and walk up Science Hill every day and stand where she stood. I miss her every day, and I want her to be proud of me. Maybe that isn't a good reason to want Yale. I should have told you I liked New Haven and the college residential system, but
thank you.
love can never lose its mystery, cause I'll never be in him.
Kids there like me talking about the bad times they've had growing up, and you'll have nothing to say on the subject. So now you're busy inventing problems so you won't be left out of the conversation. You know, other kids don't enter like a ray of sunshine into their parents' lives. I'm saying you're lucky to have ever felt about your home the way that you did. For most kids, home is exactly where the bad stuff happens, not where they go to run away from it. I'm not too sympathetic with your problems. There was something I remembered. I was 5 or 6. This house was going up. The wooden frame was being built. You and your mother were laughing as your father was hammering away. And he walks over and starts throwing you in the air. More, you kept screaming and laughing, and other kids would brush past you for their turn in line. And you stood there like an usher. The way you stood there, Mary, as if to say, this is my dad. He loves all these kids, but he loves me the most. I'll never forget that day. The house going up, kids flying up in the air, and you screaming for more.
A wrong note, I sing it. Nobody doesn't like me. If there's a problem, I duck it. I don't solve it, I just mess it up. Nobody doesn't like me. I try to be a lady. I'm a lady, I'm a fraud. I talk like I'm a lady. What I sound like is a fraud. There's a right way to lose a guy, the wrong way to keep a guy. Nobody doesn't like me. Nobody doesn't like me.
act out little scenes with them, like all the Barbies lived in one big house together. I didn't have Ken. I hated Ken. But all the Barbies lived in the dream house, and they used to have tea together, and Career Barbie used to make regular Barbie do all the housework and cook dinner and everything. Workout Barbie didn't care. She was always in front of the television, so regular Barbie had to do all the work. They were so mean to her. Career Barbie would come home and she'd say, "I'm putting food on the table. I break my back every day. The least you could do would be to have a hot meal ready for me when I get home." And then regular Barbie would cry, and Workout Barbie would just keep working out. She was obsessed. And then I remember my older brother, Jared. He used to have his G.I. Joes come over and pop off the Barbie's heads. And then one day, I went up to my room, and regular Barbie was gone. Career Barbie looked everywhere, and she was really sad, and she said, "Please come back. I promised to do my share of the housework. I'm sorry I was mean to you." And I thought, that's it. She's gone off to become a meteorologist. I used to love meteorologists until I discovered they were liars. Workout Barbie just kept on working out because she was obsessed. So Career Barbie went a little crazy. We looked everywhere for her. And then we found her. Jared's G.I. Joes had tied her to a stick in the backyard and were shooting firecrackers at her. Her whole left side had melted down. We took her down from the stick and set her up in the bed in the dream house. And Career Barbie made dinner and cleaned the house too. Workout Barbie just kept on doing aerobics because she was heartless. But then the story has a happy ending, because Career Barbie learned not to take regular Barbie for granted. And also, I took Jared's G.I. Joes and ran them over with the lawnmower. Yes.
Are you okay? Old friends. After day, after day, after day, after day, after day. up to us now to show up.
How you did it, because your mind is such a nice place these days.
I'm just talking loudly, I'm not upset. My God, you have that look on your face. They have that look, we used to imitate that look, we used to make fun of them. Now you've got that look in your face, in your eyes, in your tone of voice, that condescending voice. I shouldn't be acting this way with you.
Wherever you went, did you good. Maybe I should go there. Listen to me as if there's actually a place that can fix things. Hotel Sanity. It's gotten really bad. To the point where I can't even go on the subway platform anymore. I see traffic, I can't cross the street. Sometimes I run the other way. Do you know what it's like to not be able to cross the street? To stand there and see old people, little kids, animals cross, there I am, paralyzed. Some days I can't even leave the house. You always used to know what to say. You used to be so happy that somebody else felt the same way that you did. We used to help each other. I miss that.
Pregnant, it's only been a month. And I thought about it. Not what I would do. I didn't really think I was. It was more like the thought of being, you know, knocked up. Maybe that was or would be an idea. Not a good idea, but a way, you know? A way to, you know, a way to make you stay. I should want to keep you here, but I'm gonna be in love with other people, okay? Way more than I love you, because I know how young I am. But you're like the coolest guy I'm ever gonna get to hang with. I'm kind of in awe of you, because you're sharp enough to recognize who the coolest chick there is, and that anyone else would bore you. I know that. I'm just for now. You're just for now. I think it's better to end up with someone with low expectations. People with high expectations are less happy, I think. And because I have them, low expectations. And I'm afraid that people with high expectations will only end up being disappointed. But look on the bright side, look what I get to do. When I look back at my 2.2 kids and my not as cool husband, I get to help launch an artist, or an anarchist, or an activist, or maybe just a guy who disturbs things, when things be disturbing. And that art project of yours is awesome. I still think we should call it Art is a Weapon. But you're gonna make people look like artists are supposed to. And people are gonna hate you, like people are supposed to hate artists. The ones who make them look like it's true. Because the truth sucks. And you're gonna make them look at it. So if I have to get in a little bit of trouble, and my dad gets all Old Testament, it's worth it.
Everyone says it's like a bad thing, like I'm cursed. But I like it. I like being different. I like being the boy with skinny knees from a belt skateboard trick. I like being the boy who sits in the back of the class reading Rainbow and wondering what Ramir was really thinking. I like being the odd one out and the guy that most girls don't pay attention to. I don't care about being invisible. Because it's my superpower. I'm like a comic book character. I'm a painting. I'm a book of Shelley masterpiece that sits there on the wall and nobody sees any value in it until it's too late. I sit there on the wall and everybody walks by without seeing a thing. But I see everything. I see how guys like Jeff get everything they want in life without ever trying. Guys like Jeff always get girls like you. I get muffin in art classes and a lot of alone time, and I fall for girls I can't have. I've always known I'm different. A few years ago, I took off because my parents were fighting again. It was summer, and it was Friday. I was riding my bike along the campus. Sac City was a ghost town, and I loved it. I wouldn't have to see people, happy people, and be reminded what I would never have. I knew then what it meant to be alone. And I would be alone for the rest of my life. I rode around for hours. I watched the sun go down over the river, and I realized something. I realized I needed to protect myself. I needed to make sure I never needed anyone again. Not even you.
Good person.
person. I'm not an exploiter or a thief. That pin in your pocket, where did you get it? When was the last time you actually went out and bought a disposable pen? Do you remember? No, but I'll tell you how it got there. You took it. That's what Americans do. We take pens from everywhere. And if you took a computer, that would be theft. But no one cares if you take a pen or some paper clips. They order in bulk. But technically, you are stealing. You are a thief. That is what we're talking about here.
No fool am I, who never fell in love. It seems that I'm the only one that I've been thinking of. What kind of man is this? An empty cell. An empty cell in which a lonely heart must dwell. What kind of clown am I? What do I know of life? Why can't I cast away the mask of clay and live my life? Why can't I fall in love till I don't give a damn, and maybe then I'll know what kind of fool I am.
That was a miracle. When Santa in the wilderness. That was a miracle too. But of all God's miracles, large and small, the most miraculous one of them is the one I thought would never be. God has given
biggest fear is losing yourself to the wrong choices, or the wrong men, or the wrong jobs, or the wrong activity on a summer evening when whatever you're not doing is clearly more fun. You know, you let your brain lead your heart, and you're afraid that that won't make you happy in the end. But losing the people you actually love is even worse, right? Losing your dad, which you felt you should have been able to control, or losing me, which you're just sure will happen if and we're so important to each other. Please know that I know that. And I would never disappear. Not if you. And you could never let me down. You couldn't. We'd get through it all together, like explorers on a ship made of time itself. The sails blowing effortlessly through the churning waters. And your greatest desire? To be loved, of course, by everyone. Unconditionally, unequivocally. But what you don't understand is that my love could actually be enough. It always has been. Like, for instance, if it weren't for me, this guy wouldn't be here. We both know that. It's you, Sarah. You're you. Don't you get it?
Thank you.
play. Only watch the game. Put me to the mic. I know what I like. Don't you wanna be the life of the party? Don't you wanna be the cream of the crop? Don't you wanna feel the shivering fit? Someone calls it quits, or someone calls the cop. Don't you run with the wrong a lifetime? Well, you better get down on one knee. Cause you can play the life of the party if you can pray with me. I tell you things I haven't even told myself. I'm drawn to that. It was like everything was suddenly in perfect focus, and all I could see was your face. Your eyes. Everything was in your eyes. And I could feel myself go into them, and when I did, I was free. For the first time in maybe my whole life, I was free. You make me unafraid. You make me unafraid. You make me unafraid. You make me.
There are parts of this country, out this way, pure and wild, unknown to man. Places no human eyes have ever seen. Cave country, it is. Hundreds of miles of caves, stretching and
twisting underground. Passages and tunnels, wide open chambers, pools so deep, you would never touch the bottom. Down in the caves, you have to know what you're doing. You have to know what you're doing. You gotta remember. You gotta remember. Keep it in the back of your mind, always. And if you do, if you know your way around, you can get from here to there and back again. I could do that once. Used to. This was before. Everybody knows the stories. You know, somebody wanders into the cave, some guy, probably drunk, goes in, passes out, wakes up, and they have no idea where they are. They can't see. The darkness surrounding them, the darkness so dark, so black, so pitch black, you can't even see your hand this close to your face. And now he's getting spooked. Now he's getting turned around, and he's going around in the cave, in the walls. He doesn't know where he's going. He doesn't know what he's doing. He can't find his way. So he's doubling back and twisting down corridors, going deeper and deeper and deeper into the caves. Down there, you always feel something's wrong. Something is very, very wrong. And as you realize that everything's going wrong, you start to feel your heart beating in your chest. You feel your lungs, and your sweat, your cold, cold sweat. Walls are closing in on you, like a grave. Now you're crawling on your hands and knees, trying to find a way out. And suddenly, something up ahead, a light, dull, dim, but a shaft of light. Hope. So you start crawling faster and faster towards the light, towards freedom. And you're on your feet. And you see freedom. And the light vanishes, like it was never even there. But it is what it was. See, down in the caves, in the darkness, in the blackness, the pitch blackness, the mind plays tricks, the eyes play tricks. Seely? Seely girl? Seely? I can't be Seely. I'm coming to find you. I miss you. Please come back to me. I just want to see you again.
Goes up at 7 and you shut up time.
keep asking God what I'm for, and he tells me, gee, I'm not sure. Sweep that floor, kiddo! I started life as an orphan, a child of the street, here on Skid Row. He took me in, gave me shelter, a bed, crust of bread, and a job. Treats me like dirt, calls me a slob, which I am. I constantly pray, I'll get out of here. Please won't somebody say, I'll get out of here. Someone give me my shot, or I'll rot here. Show me how and I will, I'll get out of here. I'll start climbing uphill and get out of here. Please won't somebody say, I'll get out of here.
Give it all. what she used to be.
Because this girl I've never met, I get to meet tonight. I hate. I'm taking her to dinner at a charming cafe, but we meet tonight. I hate. It's early in the morning and our date is not till 8 o'clock tonight, and yet already I can see what a nightmare this full day will be. I haven't slept a wink. I only think of our approaching tete-a-tete tonight. I feel a combination of depression and elation with a state to wait till late. 3 more minutes, 2 more seconds, 10 more hours to go. In spite of all I've written, she may not be very sweet, and my hopes perhaps may all collapse. I put tonight at 8.
Thank you.
Blank page of canvas. So many possibilities.